So a few of you are probably hoping that this video was going to be about Pioneer 520 with tracks on it. That one will likely be the next video that we post. Maybe you like orange tractors and snow blowing. If so, then maybe you'll like this one. So it was Adam's, my dad's, and my turn to be out on our snow route. We've got more than 90 driveways and private roads and stuff like that. So we have three Kubota rigs, all have pole blowers. You're seeing the fourth one here. That one was from a larger Kubota tractor that we sold. And we haven't sold the blower yet, but it's kind of cool because you can, you know, see what it's about when it's not attached on the tractor. But anyways, yeah, so just a quick little introduction. We're out on the route blowing snow, and I thought I'd do a little combination video of like how to blow snow with a pull-type blower, different techniques and methods that we use, sort of how it's done. In the later part, you'll see I'll explain about the different components we have. And this just gives you a big picture, front-end loader, bucket, four-wheel drive Kubota HSD transmission. This is a 60 horsepower MX6000 with a cab, 78 inch snow blower on this machine, and the tractors are fully studded with ag tires. So first of all, a few myths are people are concerned about because the tractor drives over the snow first. Does it pack the snow? Sure, it packs the snow, but you're picking it up within seconds, so it is gone. You're dragging around a snow blower with a cutting edge on it that weighs, depending on the machine that you buy and the attachment. In our case, it's around 1,000 pounds with the quick hitch and the hydraulics on the back and all the snow blower and that. So when you think about that down pressure and that weight being dragged along in float mode, it's just picking up any snow that you've packed and any other vehicular traffic is usually able to be cut right off. If you get a whole bunch of traffic and the snow gets to the point where it can really firm up because you can't get to it right away, that's where you run into issues. But that kind of like doesn't really matter what type of snow blower you have, you're still going to have that problem. So it doesn't matter that you pack the snow first. Second of all, sure, there is a restriction of how much snow you can drive through with the tractor first. You can't expect to drive through a winter's worth or like a month worth of snow that's accumulated and got quite dense and settled, because then the tractor is going to be hopping and you're trying to drag the snow blower through way harder snow. But in terms of fresh snow, and that's when you want to go blowing snow, you want to get the snow basically as soon as it's hit the ground if you can, because that's when it's at its loosest state, unless of course it's really mild out and the snow is sticky and packy. Then you can run into getting plugged chutes and stuff like that. But if you can you know, get the snow when it's pretty fresh, you'll be surprised how much snow the tractor can drive through first. You can definitely be dragging the undercarriage through the snow. Yeah, so there's a couple of myths that really don't matter. So yeah, on to the rest of the video. Hope you enjoy. Yeah, subscribe if you like this kind of thing. Our videos are quite honestly going to be pretty random. You know, we'll get up to all kinds of crazy stuff. Thought it'd be really cool today since we've got a nice snowfall. We're out on the three tractors. We're taking care of our customers' driveways today. It's still snowing, but we just didn't want to let the snow get too far ahead, and we're getting lots of the road plow trucks have been out, so they're mounting up the snow a lot in front of people's driveways. So if we wait for this snowstorm or weather system to stop, we actually wouldn't probably be out until Wednesday, which is about 4 days. So yeah, we gotta keep on top of this one. Unfortunately, we don't really have clear weather in sight for about a week or so. Maybe a lot of people don't know about pull-type blowers or that they even exist. I think they've been around for quite a while, but they're pretty cool. Like, it's pretty unique. As you can see right there, it looks like some people call them inverted snow blowers, but it's basically the exact same design of a traditional push type snow blower that would go on the 3-point hitch of the tractor. The only difference is it's spun around and the PTO shaft goes through the center area, connecting up to the fan impeller
which then goes to the to a 90 degree drive that goes over to a sprocket and it drives the chain. So this setup we have here on our 60 horsepower Kubota HST tractor is a hydraulic chute rotator. It's a manual deflector on the top. So, you know, our types of driveways, we're not doing city or town driveways where you've got driveways literally like feet from another driveway. So we don't really have to worry about not launching it too far. For us, the further the better. So, oh, here comes Adam right now. I need to get out of his way. But yeah, so for us, we just need the chute rotation and to blow snow. And then on the 3-point hitch, we have, I don't know if you can see it there, but we have a hydraulic top link. And for us, that's a game changer. I think the second or third year that we've had the full blowers, we added that on. And sorry about the messy cab here. That's controlled by a remote. This Grandel 6060 comes with standard with two remotes, which is nice. So we need two remotes. So the first remote, forward and backwards. I don't know if you can see that. That's lengthening the top link, shortening the top link. I know we might have it backwards as far as the diagram's concerned or the way some people would do it, but for us, it just works, I guess, just the way you look at it, forward, backwards, up, down. I think of it kind of like an airplane. You pull up on the elevator, up it comes, push down on the elevator, and down the elevator goes. So, might think I'm a little crazy, but that's how I look at it. So, yeah, back to it. A few benefits are you're going forward, which is like if you had a front mount snowblower. Sure, that's the same. But once you get your spout of snow coming out and you get a lot of mist, tiny snowflakes, things like that, with this setup, you're driving away from it all the time when you're blowing snow. With a front mount snowblower or a rear mount traditional snowblower that's spunner, typically, you would always be driving towards your snow spout. No matter where you direct that, if you've got wind happening, and if you've ever used those types of snowblowers, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You're either in an open cab and you're getting just misted and blasted with snow, or you're constantly getting ice ups on your windows, or having your wipers going nonstop. So that for us is a huge benefit because most of our driveways are actually pretty long. So once we get going, we just want to blow snow, and you're driving and you're facing forward. So even though I'm like checking back sometimes, 95% of the time that I'm blowing snow, I'm actually, my head is straight forward. I'm going to be watching the tires, where they are in comparison to my driveway edge. Sometimes I use the bucket edge as my guide. A lot of times I'll have my loader up high so that I can see the driveway edge a little better, or if I'm coming up to somebody's parked car or something like that, I can actually get my bucket well out of the way. So yeah, and while we're at it, that's another huge benefit, is having a loader and a bucket. So you come into a construction site, who knows what guys have dropped, 2x4s, hammers, you can just push the snow out of those ways. Or if you're coming to a driveway like this, just get it into proper range here for the driver. Yeah, if you're just engaged the PTO there, so you can see the shaft spinning auger fan. So yeah, if you we come up to a driveway here, let's say this has had the chance to freeze, it's gone like really cold, plow trucks went by a week ago, you want to bust in there, you know, you don't have to put your snowblower into that if you don't want to. So of course, you know, with this type of snowblower, oh yeah, bump that sign a little bit. with this type of snowblower, you've got a bucket and loader all the time if you often option that out with your tractor. Now, typically we're out the next day and maybe the plows have just gone by, so that's the plow furrow is usually pretty soft, and it's a lot safer for us to get off the main road as quickly as we can. So I'll just start off by diving right into how we do it. Please bear with me because I don't have something to mount my camera. So I'm gonna be trying to steer and operate all these controls at the same time. So what I like to do is I get the tractor off the road as quickly as I can. I'll start off on the right side here, and I'll have my blower just pretty much on the shoulder of the road, maybe on the road a little bit, but if cars are coming or something, I'm not in their way, they can go around. So really I don't have a giant tractor on the road, and I'm off it as quick as I can. So here's what I do. I start off where my rev's up properly here. I'll take my first pass on the right. I'll come in till the driveway starts to straighten out, because I like to flare the entrance of the driveway nicely so that people can come in and turn right or left or whatever they've got to do. I'll just have my chute aimed forward of the tractor just a little bit so that I'm not going to accidentally hit a car's windshield as they're driving by. So I usually do 3 or 4 passes driveway entrance. I don't even need to change my chute because it's still angled forward just a little bit. I don't know if you can tell. We'll do the 4th pass here. You can, a little trick is you can kind of lower your blower a little bit just to shove the mound down a bit out of the way so your tractor's not, you know, your tires aren't climbing and the tractor's going all over the place. Usually I'll turn the chute rotator whatever way the wind's going. I like to blow the snow with the wind just so I get a little bit less snow hitting the glass and causing water buildup or whatever. So as you can see there, I'm driving away from that mist. But I don't usually do this. I usually would just keep going in that situation, but I like to blow the right side of the driveway for some reason. So I'll get my loader up a bit here so you can see my tire. There's the driveway edge. It's sort of hard to see right now, but I'll space the tire, whatever you need to do. Like, it depends on the width of that you blow the, sorry, that depends on the width of the blower that you have. So this is a 78 inch, and I guess I've given about 8 or 10 inches, and it depends. You just have to get used to it. Like, it just takes practice. You know, you get a feel for your tractor. If you're using the same one every time, you just know when you come to turns and that kind of thing, where the blower is going to be in relation to where you're actually driving the tractor. So, now you can see there, I'm pretty much on the edge. It's kind of hard because I'm filming at the same time. I normally have, you know, the one hand on the knob here, which is super handy. My dad, I think on his tractor, he's got 2 or 3 of these. So no matter where you reach, I mean, I think that's pretty handy. I should probably do that on this one, but yeah, so here's a nice long driveway here. It's probably 800 feet or 600 or 800 feet, I don't really know, but it's got a mix. It's mostly flat, but we're coming up to a kind of a nasty little hill. Now, I always try to blow downhill. That's another tip. You can go up some grades, definitely, especially if you have studs on the tractor, like our setups. You can definitely blow up some smaller grades. It's just going to be putting more pressure on your studs. You might be spinning your tires more. You just do a lot better job, and it's easier on your machines if you blow going down the hill. So then what I'll do next is, because it's more efficient for me to turn around and blow going back out, I don't want to back all the way up to the start of the driveway again. But because I have this hill, I'll just back up just to the top of the hill so that I can, when I'm blowing out, I just lift my blower and drive right out. So typically for a driveway with a 78 inch blower, it's more than enough to do 1.5 blower widths. So now all I do is I look for the left edge of the snow blower where I went before, and I'll just straddle that left edge. I know you can't really see it because I sort of crushed it with the tires there, but you know, normally if I was just driving back out, you'll see an easy line to straddle. So now I'll curve back onto the right side and just kind of continue my line. And I'll find the right side of the driveway again. Now, here at this customer, we've got a garage, which is good for the sake of this video, because that's one of the negatives for a full-time floor, is garage. And the reason for that is, you probably guessed it, but you're constantly packing snow in front of the driveway where you drop the blower. Now, I'm just going to change my location here. Most of these, the companies that build these, this is an MK Martin snowblower. Most of the companies that build these offer an extra cost, actually like a blade, a hydraulic blade on the back. So I could back up here if I had the blade. I'll just walk it up. I could drop the blade, you know, I drop the snowboard a bit, but then drop the blade. Then you could go forward, scrape the snow away from the blower, the garage, and then you'd back up, then you would lift the blade, drop the snow blower, and then you would just continue blowing, and whatever you pulled away from the garage door, you would blow that away, and then it would continue on. But for us, the people that actually use their garages in the winter time, we ask them for either like the garage door code, or you know, could have a remote. Some people don't even they don't really keep anything in the garage, so they don't even lock it. So I'll just go in, hit the button, open the door up, and then I can actually back the snow blower in, drop it on the garage floor, and then drive forward, finish up, and then close the garage, and then, you know, I'm on my way. So that's what we do, and it seems to work pretty well. So for the people that need their garage entrance nice and cut nice and low, then you just say, well, please, you know, give us a way to open the door, and we'll take care of it. So that's the way we get around garages. You know, you can spend the extra money and get that blade attachment, but you know, don't forget, you can do that, but then you need a third remote if you have a top link like we do. Let's talk about the top link next while we're on it. Because we have so many driveways that we do, and they all vary from like hills up and down, and some with like dips and crests, it makes it hard to set your top link with a typical fixed, you know, just an adjustable top link like you would get with the tractor. You have to, you're gonna, you know, adjust that manually and try to find the sweet spot that works with, you know, most driveways or whatever. But that's fine if you, you know, just have one driveway, or say all your driveways are flat. But that's not the case for us. You know, we're in Northern Ontario, we're in the Canadian Shield. There's granite everywhere. And almost nothing is flat. So, you know, as we, I'll just show you here. So, also want to point out that all our driveways, it's early February now, the frost is definitely in the ground. So all the gravel bases, which are most of our driveways, are completely frozen like concrete. And it's awesome for us at this stage of the game because we don't need to worry about like digging into gravel. And you still can get into it if you're not careful with like using the bucket. But so yeah, I'll show you first of all while I'm doing this parking area. Backing up, dropping the blower, pretty basic. I'm not adjusting the top link. Got my chute rotation set that works for this particular parking spot. Oh, I don't like turning with my right hand. I'm being conscious all the time where the snow spout is going. That's the right word, spout. I don't know. Not hitting anybody's windows or dumping on top of a parked boat or firewood piles. Usually there's lots of objects you gotta avoid, whether you're in a town or you're in a cottage country. But yeah, so it's just a simple back and forth, raising and lowering. So that's a huge benefit for HST. If you're doing a lot of back and forth, go for HST. If you have a big farm tractor and you can't get HST in the horsepower range that you need, that's fine. You can still use a gear tractor. It's just you got to be a lot better with your gotta be good with your clutching and forward and reverse and all that good stuff. Here's a spot where I just kind of went in a dip. Now I'm cresting a little bit. So if I'm not careful, I actually could dive into the gravel right there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to lengthen the top link a bit, and you'll see the angle change. So the snowblower can kind of float over top of the crest of a hill rather than chopping into it. As I flatten out on the top, I can get the snowblower kind of level again. You gotta watch out here, bunch of kayaks, stuff like that. So yeah, and so the big benefits of the top link for us is infinite adjustability while you're blowing snow to either try to cut your snow base down. So if you're getting to a spot where lots of vehicles have packed the snow, before you can actually get to clearing the snow, which happens on a lot of private roads and driveways like that, then you can when you do get out to do the snow, you can chop it down, which is nice. And then the other benefit that in the fall, let's say before the in early winter, before the driveway base is really frozen solid if you're on gravel or that kind of driveway. Then you can kind of make this, we kind of nickname it buttering, but you can kind of make the snow blower ride over top and kind of pack the snow under the blower more than you are actually blowing the snow away. So we call it cut. You can cut the base down a bit, or we can float over top called buttering. Just look, picture a butter knife over a piece of bread, packing the butter down rather than scooping the butter away. So here's a great little example of a spot where, all right, rather than me backing out, turning around to finish this area up nicely, I'm just gonna lift the blower and then I can back up. And then what I could do, my little pile there, can't really see it, but that gets left behind from the snow blower. I can actually just take the bucket, take the bucket and I can just push it forward and get it out of the way. Now, if you didn't want that snow pile there, which obviously will accumulate over the winter time, then you could just
you just back all the way out and then back in with the tractor and then just blow that away. But for this particular location, I don't need to do that. I can just save some time and use the bucket to push, just back up that little bit and then push where the snowblower stopped, push it forward and into a pile and out of the way.
Okay, so here I am turning around in the lower parking spot for this driveway. So there's tons of trees. You always have to be watching both ends of your tractor all the time. Eyes on the back of your head is a pretty good saying right now. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do my my last pass leaving the driveway. So I've come in, I've done a full pass, full width of the blower, which is about 2/3 of the driveway width. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to finish up and I'm going to take the last half pass. So as I leave the driveway. So I'll just get to the spot where I see half of the driveway left. Pretty tight in here. It's a really narrow spot of this particular driveway, so I don't want to lose the tractor off the edge right now. But here you go. Okay, so there you can see I'm straddling the edge, like the tractor, the middle of the tractor. Pretty much on the edge of the where the blower went through. I'll show you when we get to another spot here. This is that hill spot that I did coming down. So now I'm just merging back, and this is full width right now. So I can pick my blower up. I'm not trying to drag it all the way up the hill. So the blower is off the ground. And you can see here, this is where I backed up to before when I was coming in. So I can merge back up to that, drop my snowblower back down, line that up with the edge. And now I'm, rather than focusing so much on the right edge of the driveway, I'm more just going to watch my blower line there. And just, for the most part, I'm just gonna straddle it on the way out. It's just a little bit easier than staring at the edge over there. I already did that coming in on that side, and now I know because I maintain this driveway, all I have to do on the way out is straddle that line where the snowblower, where the left edge of the snowblower was. And then that gives me a nice edge. I'll just show you. The snow drops down here. There you can see the edge there. Lines up pretty nice with the driveway. So yeah, it's, you know, if I wasn't filming right now, I'd be more focused and just kind of like the camera is right now, just looking forward. So yeah, I'm just coming out of the driveway. As you can see here. And now I basically have no snow in the blower, so I can slowly lift it up, and that's it. Plow truck still has to come by because it's still snowing, but we won't get too much of a mound there because there's only about an inch on the road right now. So there you go. You can see. Oh yeah, there goes my snacks. You can see the finished driveway. thing about these blowers, you really don't leave any tracks behind. So it kind of looks like a freshly groomed snowmobile trail, or it almost looks like a trail groomer of some kind. It's just flattened it right out. So, you know, obviously it's kind of silly, but I think that's kind of neat. Just, you don't leave any bar tread or any kind of tread behind, really. So once the temperature dips down, that nice smooth snowy surface is going to get nice and firm. And again, we don't like to let our bases get too thick because we typically get a few melts, mild spells in the winter time. And if your snow base is too thick, as soon as you try to drive on the driveway and it's mild, like above freezing, car tires just dive into it, people struggle for traction, and then once it freezes again, you get all these like horrible ruts, and just, you know, try to keep off of it when it gets warm, but you know, sometimes you gotta use your driveway. So but that's just a nice benefit of being able to kind of continually cut the driveway base down. It's been a few hours since I started the video earlier this morning. Been hammering down snow non-stop, going through about 14 or 16 inches here on this private lane, and the tractor is not having any problem driving through that. Keep that in mind with the blow blower, your tractor has to drive through first. So while I'm thinking of it, I'm going to do a description with this video, and I will put pros and cons. And if there's any updates I have to add, like if somebody posts some comments or has some questions or something like that, I can answer it there and just kind of keep it updated in case I forget something while I'm building this. So yeah, also I forgot to add that we have a 3-point hitch, quick hitch on the back, which allows us to just connect attachments pretty quickly. But the attachments have to be compatible with that, so there's a downside there. But another benefit is it actually moves the snowblower backwards about 5 inches or so. So it lengthens the PTO shaft, it has less angle on the PTO shaft, so it actually helps the lifespan of the U-joints quite a bit, because you don't have the same angles, like the PTO shaft doesn't have to go down and make those angle changes as aggressively. So that's a nice thing. It also adds about 150 pounds, depending on which one you buy, onto the back of the tractor. One thing to consider too, if you've got a loader on the front, you really don't need any ballast. The weight of the loader, and then of course if you need more ballast, you can grab a really good bucket of, say, dense snow, and it'll help with traction on the front. The tractor. So I'm pretty sure that sums it up. You know, if you're just getting into snow blowing, or you want to just getting into snow removal, maybe you're getting your first tractor, or you've had tractors with different setups and you're curious about the full type inverted snow blower, hopefully this video helps you out. Definitely do a setup like this on a smaller tractor. If you don't even need a cab, you can do manual chute rotator. You don't have to have top link, hydraulic top link, so that you don't need to spend money on remotes. It just depends on how much time you're spending in the tractor and what type of equipment you're comfortable with. And, you know, you can be out in the elements and whatnot. And then on top of that too, if you're into it commercially, to consider, you can't re-blow the snow with this type of blower. With a front mount blower or a traditional rear mount blower, you can aim the chute ahead of where the snow blower is going, so you could actually keep re-blowing and recycling that snow until you get it out of the way or wherever you're trying to haul it to. So you can't do that with a pole blower, so that's one negative side. You can, however, can almost launch it over the tractor. It would probably, most of it would end up on the pass, but as you can see now, I have it aimed forward by quite a bit. So you do have a little bit of flexibility there, but you're still not re-blowing the snow. And not many people do that, but you know, on your loader, you could attach, say, like a snow pusher, like a very broad blade with ends on it, just to be able to clear, you know, large lots and things like that a bit faster. But that's something you would just deal with if you had, say, a large parking area, you know, at a commercial type location. So, you know, there's all kinds of different setups. Great if you leave some comments, I'll try to answer them. Any questions you have, hopefully you like, and maybe subscribe if you're interested in this kind of thing. We also, there's going to be all kinds of videos eventually whenever we get around to it. Any might seem a bit random, but anything from you know, building a chicken coop to indoor gardening, gardening, vegetable gardening in general. You know, we're all pretty busy, but we'll try our best. So until then, happy shoveling. By the way, the only downside to having this much grass, I think, I was just thinking about it. If you're in mid-pit, not that I think we know, but let's just say, hypothetically, you're in mid-pit, you've got nowhere to hide. Someone walks out behind the tree or another house or something, there you are. You literally have nowhere to hide.